Good morning, everyone. I'd like to extend a special welcome to any guests we might have with us. Will you please stand and join me, and let's bring glory to our King this morning.
Out. If we don't, now's the time to raise a song. Hear creation shout aloud. We will join our voices to that sound. The rocks are gonna cry out.
If we don't, now it's time to raise a song. Hear creation shout loud. We will join our voices to the sound.
Stand up, stand up, the time has come. Sing it out, sing it at them to His name. Generation of worshiping unashamed. Give it all for the glory of our King. We will run after Your heart. We believe You are all that You say You are. Give it all for the glory of our King.
Waking up.
The church is waking up now to be Your hands and feet upon this earth.
Send us in Your power as we take heaven to a broken world.
Stand up, stand up. The time has come.
Sing it out, sing an anthem to His name. Generation worshiping unashamed. Of our King. We will run after Your heart. We believe You are all that You say You are. Give it all for the glory of our King.
The glory of our King. The glory of our King.
We are chosen people.
We are Your chosen people. We are called to follow. We are Your generation. Oh Lord, you are the God who saves us.
You are the God who sends us. You are
the God who's with us.
Ashamed. Give it all for the glory of our King. We will run after Your heart. We believe You are all that You say You are. Give it all for the glory of our King.
The glory of our King. The glory of our
And could you help me thank our worship team for starting us off in a great way this morning? Awesome. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Tom Hughes. It's my privilege to be able to welcome us every Sunday morning to service. We're thrilled that you're here at Prairie Bible Church and looking forward to a great time to just worship the Lord. In the Bible, Jesus taught us the two most important commandments. The first greatest commandment, He said, was to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And the second greatest commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself. We truly try to come into that each and every Sunday and each and every day of the week here at Prairie Bible Church and hope that we can continue to spread that love in the world. If you are new and you are worshiping here with the first time for us or one of the first few times, welcome. We're glad that you joined us, and we hope that you would maybe just grab a welcome packet. It's in the back table. It's just a chance for you to get a little bit more information about us with some folders in there and things that we're going on here, as well as some of our beliefs and our purposes, and hope that you would take that chance. And as we do every week, I'm going to just start the attendance pads around. If you would be willing to just put your name and contact info on there so we can know that you worship with us. The other thing we always like to do is pass out the prayer cards. Hannah's got prayer cards. If you got a joy or a concern that you'd like to share with our family here this morning, please grab one of the girls, grab a prayer card, and then we'll collect those during our songs and share them out during our community prayer time. Excuse me. We've got a lot of things going on, so I hope that that little half sheet that's on your chair that's got some of those details on it that you're taking a look at and or you're paying attention to our weekly email. But I'm going to run through some really quick ones that are coming up really soon that I want to make sure everybody knows about. One is that you have to be registered for the One Woman Conference in Ames. It's been in the info. If you want more information about that, Leanne Westcott's kind of heading that up. Make sure you get registered for that. If you want to do that, it's end of September, September 27th, 28th. The other thing is, this Tuesday is last Tuesday coffee at Cava House for anyone available, 9 to 10:30. Welcome to anybody from Prairie Bible Church or others, friends, just to come talk about Jesus and what's going on. Make sure that everybody knows about that this Tuesday. And today, there's multiple things going on today. Tonight, high school youth group is meeting at the Grimm's house. So if you know a high schooler, if you have a high schooler and you want to push them towards a youth group, pizza, I had this written down here, pizza, praise, and prayer. 6:30 for high schoolers. How can you get any better than that? Make sure that if you have questions about that, let myself know or any of the Grimm's, Freshman Craig, we'll make sure we get people to there. The other thing that's happening today, in case you hadn't noticed, how many churches do you go to when you pull in the parking lot and you see a line of motorcycles? It's what Craig dreams of. For his whole career, he's always dreamed to go to a church where there's motorcycles lined up every Sunday, right? But unless he goes to San Diego or Arizona, he's probably going to have to do this half the year, right? It's a little tough in December. But as a reminder, it's the second annual PBC motorcycle ride up to Stone City today. You can see the bikes that are headed up there after service. We want to make sure a couple of things. You do not have to have a motorcycle to go. They're going up for lunch up there and would welcome any and all to be able to caravan up there. With that said, we'd love to get a rough count on how many might be willing to go or planning to go. So if you are headed to Stone City on a motorcycle caravan, could you raise your hand so we can get a rough count? About 15 or so, Lisa? Okay, awesome. And Sherwin has got a motorcycle he's riding today, and he's kind of feeling lonely. He's got a seat behind him that he would love to have some companionship driving up to Stone City. If anybody either just wants to go or, more importantly, maybe has never ridden a motorcycle, has time and interest today, Sherwin is your man. Catch him afterwards. It's your great chance to ride a motorcycle. Emil wants to know if it's a race or not. Sherwin, is it a race? I guess the only one way to find out, Emil, are you signing up? There you go. It's just a wonderful, good example of we are here to worship God, to love God, but at the end of the day, too, we're about relationships and having fun, and that's great, and we're thrilled that we can do that in church. It's kind of another thing that just happened last night along the same tone. Our worship leader, who we now have gotten to know and feel better about, and Jesse, is doing a great job worshiping in song, but he's also trying to help the community. He had a little fundraising campaign here recently, where he was set to raise $1,000 for Youth for Christ to put towards students in our community. And to then, if he could raise that $1,000, he was going to go over the edge for youth. And we've got a short little video to prove that he went over the edge. Awesome job, Jesse. There you go. He said he's never done that before. He truly went over the edge. And remember, it truly is awesome that it was for $1,000. And I know many of us here at Prairie Bible Church help support him. And so thank you, I think, from Jesse's standpoint to do that. But it's an awesome experience. That was awesome. And Emil, that makes writing with Sherwin look pretty easy now, doesn't it? Amen to that. Okay. Would you all join me in opening prayer as we come into our worship time? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Each and every day that you wake us up, that you give us breath to breathe and a heartbeat to move us forward. We also thank you for this great family, the relationships, the joy, the love that we can share with one another, but also the fun and the experiences and the companionship that we can give to help us grow stronger and then share that love with so many other people in the world. And as we say many times, that we can be an example of your love, Lord. And we pray that whether we're rappelling down a building, whether we're driving motorcycles, whether we're sharing pizza, that we can truly just show your love and that people then can see that through us. And they can ask why and how and want to be a part of it and want to know more about you. We're so thrilled that people that were able to gather here this morning, that they can feel your presence, feel your spirit. We pray about this worship service, that you would anoint it, that you would bless it, and truly help us to be servants to you, to worship you this morning. We pray that we could all also be refreshed and revived so that we can go out and share that message, share that light with all we come into contact with in this coming week. We pray for those that weren't able to join us this morning, that they would feel your presence as ours as well, to know that they are loved and cared for. We ask all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
So before I went over, obviously they wanted to give me some training. They wanted to make sure that I wasn't going to fall flat on my face. And what they told me during my training, there were two ropes, right? And what they told me during my training was each one of those ropes could hold 6,000 pounds. Yeah, I felt safe. I felt secure because I might weigh quite a bit, but I don't weigh 6,000 pounds, right? Okay, so I felt better about taking the plunge. I felt better about going over the edge. And I really think that our faith is like that. We can look in Scripture and we can hear the testimonies of other witnesses, and what we can conclude is that God is secure. I can put my weight into him. I'm not going to fall flat on my face. So with that, would you please stand and join me in singing this next song? With every breath,
with every word I speak, with every step, with every heartbeat, Jesus, let it be for you only, my whole life, all for your glory.
Sing that again.
With every breath, with every word I speak, with every step, with every heartbeat, Jesus, let it be for you only, my whole life, all for your glory.
Life is secure in him.
My life is in your hands. I trust it all to you. My dreams and all my plans. I trust it all. Forever I've changed. I'll never be the same because of your love. Because of your love. Forever I've changed. I'll never be the same because of your love. Because of you, Jesus. Because of you, Jesus. Whoa,
you're my guide.
For all my days, God, you are my guide. I give you all. My heart is open wide. forever in love with you.
You are everything, everything. You are all I need, all I need. I am forever in love with you. Forever in love with you. You are everything, everything. You are all I need, all I need. I am forever in love with you. My life is in your hands. I trust it all, I trust.
There's a reason why we can trust him. Of all the miracles we look back to, the greatest by far is the miracle of the resurrection, that Christ poured out his blood for us, but he didn't stay down, that he raised from the dead, which set a precedent for us that someday we will rise. It's the greatest promise and our greatest hope. So let's sing. There is a fountain.
There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains.
Amen.
Violet tears.
saved to sin no more, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more.
Please be seated.
Good morning, church. If you'll please pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with joy. Joy that we are made clean, saved to sin no more. We praise you, your Son, as the unblemished Lamb who took the punishment for sin in our place. We praise you as our Creator, the one who spoke this world into existence, who spoke us into life. We praise you as Emmanuel, God with us. We praise you as the Rock and the Redeemer, the Light in the darkness. We thank you, Lord, this morning for the ability to come together, the freedom that is here in the United States, that we can gather anytime, anywhere, and lift up our praises to you. We thank you, Lord, for the Holy Bible, your word to us. We ask that you give us wisdom, wisdom to make it a daily habit to get in to your word, wisdom to understand your messages to us, wisdom to live in the way that you outline for us that leads to a joyful, flourishing, full, and complete life. We thank you, Lord, for this space. We thank you for College Community School District so willingly opening their doors to us. We ask that you put your hedge of protection around this space, fill it with your goodness, and help us to be a light in this community. May others come to know you through us merely meeting here, and may we serve them beyond. We lift up the prayer concerns from our family today. We pray for Wanda White, who's spending her last days in hospice. Wanda's a friend of Sherry Haight. We just pray that Wanda has your peace in these last days here on earth, and she has joy in what you have in store for her. We pray for the new Transitional Care Center. Ms. Mackenzie Grimm shared that with us. We just pray for that care center, that the Lord's healing be evident in the care that's given for those many staff and professionals that are working to help rehabilitate folks in our community. May they see you through the different staff that's there. We also pray for the high school youth that are meeting tonight. We pray that your word goes out. We pray that hearts are opened. We pray that schedules are freed up so friends can attend. We pray for confidence that those kids can invite their friends and your word can spread in only the way that you do, which is always good and right. We pray all these things that were shared in the cards and those that are in our hearts. We ask that your will be done, your kingdom come. Amen. Kids, if you want to come forward, I have a short message. Good. Rachel, I'm so glad you're here. Yay, I've missed you on the carpet. Hi, guys, come on up if you want. Oh, Noah, good to see you. Come on up. All right. Hi, Bryn. Okay, guys, today we are going to talk about, has anybody started school yet? Oh, good. I have a lot of hands. I have a couple that haven't quite started school yet. But on your first day or before you went to school, did you take a backpack? Okay, I want to hear some of the things you guys put in your backpacks. What had to go to school? Miss Cayenne?
My lunch.
Lunch. Noah, what'd you need in your backpack?
Supplies.
Okay. Give me some examples of school supplies. Rachel, what'd you take to school in your backpack?
Clothes.
Some extra clothes, yeah, in case you need them. I love it. Cameron, what'd you take in your backpack?
Shoes.
Shoes, yeah, you might need some special shoes for PE. Henry, what'd you take in your backpack?
A binder.
A binder, yeah.
I have
you have a backpack for fun. I love it, yeah. So we take, when we start school, we take a lot of stuff in our backpack. And sometimes your backpacks are so full you can't even zip them up, you know, all that stuff. And then you unpack it all. And Henry let me borrow his backpack today because I have something in this backpack that I want you guys to take in your backpack every single day. Do you have space in your backpack, do you think? Yeah, I'm thinking you do. You have space in this backpack because I want you guys to take Jesus with you every single day when you go to school. Now, do you have to like fold him up and pack him in here? No, no. You have Jesus in your heart. You have him. How do we talk to him when we're at school? Well, you can pray anytime, anywhere. Absolutely. And when we take Jesus with us to school, I brought my Bible here in this backpack, but I just wanted to share with you the power that you have when we take Jesus to school with us in our backpack. And I am in the book of Galatians. I'm in chapter 5, and this is the fruit of the Spirit. And I know I've shared this with you guys before, but it's a great reminder. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I think as God's people, we need all of those things so much more than we need our binders and our pencils when we go to school. So I want you guys to ask Jesus to come with you each and every day to school so he can help you bring all those things to love your classmates and love your teachers and be gentle and kind. Can you guys pray with me?
Dear Heavenly Father,
thank you for going with us. Everywhere. Please help us show your love, kindness, goodness, and all the fruit of the Spirit. In your name we pray. Amen.
I am Hannah Hughes, and today I will be doing our scripture reading. I'm reading John chapter 17, verse 23. I in you, and they in me. Bring them together with such complete unity that the world might know that you've sent me and that you love them just as you have loved me.
Hannah. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Would you please bow your heads and let's pray into the message time. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. That is the message of the gospel wrapped up in an old familiar hymn. The fact of the matter is, Jesus, we are that song. We are people who have fallen short of your glory, and we are people who have been loved so much by the creator of the universe that you are willing to sacrifice all to receive and to experience grace and acceptance and forgiveness, even in the midst of our brokenness and sin. And I want to thank you for that, Jesus. As we prepare to celebrate the sacrament of communion this morning, Lord, may we be reminded in the midst of all of that, that one of our great privileges as Christians is to be and to share those truths, that grace, that forgiveness, that peace that goes beyond all human understanding, to share that with the world, because it's a world that is not even aware that those things are available to them most of the time. It's a world that finds itself in the midst of darkness, yearning for some light, and we have been called, we have been created by you to provide the light, to be your hands, your feet in the world, to express your love, your grace, your mercy, and your truth to a world that needs all those things in desperate measure. We claim the promise found in Isaiah 55:11 that says, truly when it is your words that go out, they shall not come back empty. And that's my prayer this morning. My humble prayer is that you would use me, Jesus, as a vessel of your Holy Spirit, that the word spoken today would be your word and not my own. And if there is anything that I might be inclined to say that is not of you, don't let it be done. I pray, Lord, that you would just confuse my mind or shut my mouth, whatever, however you need to do it. Only let your word, your truth, and your mercy be proclaimed this day. So it is with those requests and trusting in your promises that we come before you this morning, and we can with great confidence know that you are here, ready to receive all that we have to offer. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Have y'all ever met somebody who seems to thrive on conflict? Maybe you're married to somebody like that. I don't know. Don't raise your hands if that's what you're thinking. I've got several friends that would probably fall into that category. My wife is not one of them, by the way. Which seems kind of ironic because personally, I'm a conflict avoider. Anybody else in the room a conflict avoider? And it seems ironic that I would be drawn towards people who thrive on conflict until I realize, you see, what I've discovered over the years is that sometimes living by the mantra, avoid conflict at all cost, just creates more conflict. Have you ever noticed that? So I believe that one of the reasons why I have gathered a group of friends who seem to thrive on conflict is because I see something in them that I'm lacking. I know that oftentimes it's better, in a healthy way if possible, to confront an issue rather than simply avoid it. That's the healthiest way to do it. Now, there's a balance. I've noticed about these friends that seem to thrive on conflict, they have a tendency sometimes to create conflict in situations where they don't need to have conflict. So there is a balance. And I think that's one of the reasons why they've probably been drawn into relationship with me, is because they maybe see something in me that they don't have, which makes us all better. That's the way it's supposed to work, by the way. Have you ever noticed that? Well, I share that with you this morning because I know that conflict is a part of everybody's life. And what we struggle with as human beings is how to deal with conflict in a healthy and Christian way. Now, here's the deal. There's a lot of people who believe that as Christians, we are called to avoid conflict at all costs. And that is not what the Bible teaches. So today what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some biblical tools that will help you to approach conflict in a healthy way that will ultimately lead to everything being better. All right? And this tool that I want to share with you today is called Christian unity. Now, even saying that, I know right now that you all are misinterpreting what Christian unity really is. And that's what this scripture today is going to help us to understand. Because people have misunderstood the concept of Christian unity, we have found ourselves as Christians in destructive relationships. Not just Christians, but even Christians. Because we think Christian unity means one thing when ultimately it means something else. So, if that's something that you think you could use a little help with today, how to approach inevitable conflict in a healthy and Christian way, I invite you to open up your Bibles to the Gospel of John chapter 17. And as you're doing that, as I try to do every week, I'll give you a little context for the passage that we're going to be looking at today. So, here in John chapter 17, the scene that we're giving entree into could easily be, you know, at the top of a lot of Bibles, they'll have different sections entitled certain things. Well, the particular section that we're going to look at today could easily have been described or entitled The Calm Before the Storm. Now, why is that? Well, what is happening here, unbeknownst to everybody else except to Jesus, Judas has already put his plan of betrayal into motion. Nobody knows that but Jesus. And because Jesus knows it's happening, he realizes that his time here on earth is quickly drawing to a close. And there are some things that he needs to say, some truths that he needs to reinforce in his disciples. So he uses this time effectively and graciously, I guess you could say. So he shares with them some things that maybe he hasn't shared with them before. Here in John chapter 17, he reinforces some things, as I mentioned before. But ultimately, the best use of his time is he decides to pray. And he prays for three things here in chapter 17, John chapter 17. He prays for himself because he knows what's about to happen and he's freaked out. He doesn't want to do it. He doesn't want to face it, but he knows he needs to, because sometimes doing the right thing is hard, right? So he prays for himself. He prays for his remaining 11 disciples. And then he prays for you. Actually, he prays for every Christian that will come into the fold from in all time and in all places. And here's what he prays for. This is the ironic thing. The thing, of all the things that he could pray for on your behalf, Jesus prays for Christian unity. John 17:23, you heard Hannah. Now envision this. Jesus is praying to his papa, to his dad. He's talking to God. And he says, I in you, and they in me, bring them together in such complete unity that the world might know that you have sent me. In other words, what he's saying is, I want you to use my people, not just the disciples. I want you to use God. I want you to use my people as evidence to the world that you sent me into the world. He says, I and you, they and me, bring them together in such complete unity that the world might know that you have sent me and that you love them just as you have loved me. All right. Now, if you listen closely as I recited that verse to you, some of you are probably thinking, well, that's one prayer that never got answered. Because I don't think there has ever been a time in history when Christians agreed on everything, right? You know what I'm talking about. So my question is, why? Was it because God wasn't listening? I don't think so. If you ever think that the reason why you don't get your prayers answered is because God isn't listening, perish the thought. God is always listening. There's another reason. If you didn't get your prayer answered, or probably more accurately, if you didn't get your prayer answered the way you wanted your prayer answered, there's another reason other than God wasn't listening. God is always listening. Maybe it's because God isn't going to make us human beings do things. That's true, right? God never makes anyone do anything. God could make you do things. God has the power to make you do things. But the fact is, one of the greatest gifts that God has given you is free will. God is going to allow you to make whatever choice you choose to make. So that possibility is probably more right than the first one. I think, however, there's something else going on here than even that. I think what's happening is that most Christians have misinterpreted what Jesus was asking for. Bring them together in complete unity. Most of us believe that Jesus was asking God, just as I alluded to a moment ago, that Jesus is asking God for us to agree on everything, to get along. But when you think about it, that's kind of a silly idea. Every single one of you are different. You view life from a different perspective. You have different tastes, different likes and dislikes. It's just, to agree on everything is just silly. In fact, I would go so far as to say, for us to agree on everything would be boring, right? So, if that's not what was going on here, if Jesus, when he said bring them together in complete unity, And it didn't mean have them agree on everything. What was he praying for? Well, remember, all the time I'm asking, I'm saying, listen, you got to understand context. You got to take time when you're reading your Bible. You don't ever just lift a verse out of its context and say, okay, I'm going to build my understanding or my theology about God on this one verse. Never, never, never do that. Because context and history is so important that you will become something not Christian if that's what you decide to do. So, we need to understand more context here. And the deeper context of what's going on here in it's more than just one chapter, is that Jesus is having his last supper with his disciples during this time. Okay? Now, why is that important? A whole bunch of stuff happens during his last supper, right? They're celebrating the Seder meal. We're going to do that in just a minute. He washes their feet. That's kind of cool, right? It teaches you something that I'm not going into today, but there's something very cool that is taught in that. But if you recall, one of the most important things that happens in this scene, in this whole experience, which we have dubbed the Last Supper, Jesus gives them a new commandment. So, what is this new commandment? Do you remember? He says, I give to you this new commandment, and it is to love one another. Now, y'all are going, there's nothing new about loving one another. Everybody knows what love is. I'm here to tell you, I don't think most people know what love is. You may think you know what love is, but you don't know what love is. Jesus was giving them this new commandment to love one another, and the love that he was teaching them, that not only through his words, but through his actions, was something that was so countercultural that the culture wouldn't even recognize it. Bring them together. A new commandment to love one another. The world's definition of love is, if you love me, I'll love you. If you'll do this for me, I will do this for you. And by the way, if you don't love me, I won't love you. And if you don't do this for me, I won't do that for you. What was so revolutionary about this love that Jesus was talking about was, he says, this is the way I want you to love one another. I want you to say, I'm going to love you whether you love me or not. I'm going to be kind and respectful to you whether you're kind and respectful to me or not. By the way, it's not no different today than it was 2,000 years ago, is it? It's still, this new commandment is still countercultural. The world doesn't get it when they see love like that and they pay attention. Now, it's not to say that they embrace it, but they'll go, that's weird. And some people are drawn to it, and other people are going, that's just weird, right? So, when Jesus says in John 17:23, when he says, bring them together in complete unity, he's not saying, Lord, have them agree on everything. He's saying, Lord, unite them in this radical counterculture kind of love. Bring them together in unity of understanding that says, I'm going to love even if you don't love me back. I'm going to respect you even if I don't agree with you. Because when you do that, when you love that way, when you're brought together in that kind of unity, the world will notice. Now, that is, again, doesn't mean they're going to love you because you're doing it. But they will notice. That makes sense, doesn't it? Unite them in this kind of love. Because the world will notice. Actually, it makes everything better. It doesn't make sense to think that he was praying, Lord, have them agree on everything. The Christian unity means the Christians agree on everything. And then, because when you buy into that, that misinterpretation, you also then buy into the misinterpretation that says, well, then if I do have conflict with somebody, if I don't agree with them, then, and that you will, by the way, that'll happen. When that happens, I find I'm in conflict with someone, then if you buy into that lie that says that Jesus says Christian unity means you agree all the time, it also then will cause you to believe that you are called to avoid conflict at all costs too. And we've already determined that's not healthy. It's good sometimes to avoid conflict when it's not that big a deal. But simply avoiding it all the time just makes everything a mess because it doesn't go away. Jesus never once said, agree on everything. Jesus never once said, avoid conflict at all costs. What he said was, be united in a new commandment. Let that which defines you as a Christian and as Christians be unconditional love. Even, maybe especially when you disagree with one another. Because what happens when the world finds itself in conflict? It leads to arguments, often hatred, and then violence, right? What should define a Christian individually in relationships that we experience and corporately is an unconditional love that says, I'm sorry, but I'm not playing into this. I'm going to choose to love you and respect you even if you don't love and respect me back. I have no idea if any of you have brought conflict into church today or not. I suspect you did. I mean, having enough people here that somebody is. Listen to what Jesus is saying to you today. Stop avoiding it and address it by loving people unconditionally, loving your spouse or your friend unconditionally, whether they are treating you nice or not. You're thinking, how do I do that, right? Because she just pushes my buttons. I'll tell you how you do it. God has not only given us that book, he has also given us the most beautiful, perfect reflection of unconditional love that the world could ever know. And his name is Jesus. Amen? Somebody say amen. It was 2,000 years ago. And there was a party going on in Jerusalem, right? They were celebrating because it was called the Passover. It was this big, long celebration where people who were of like mind of the Jewish faith would gather together for this remembrance, this carnival, if you will. It was a carnival atmosphere, but it was all based in their spiritual belief system. And part of this party was that they would have meals together. That's a great thing. When you eat together, there's always wonderful things that happen when you eat together. And Jesus had brought together his friends, his closest friends, his disciples, and they were going to celebrate during the Passover this thing called the Seder meal. What they didn't know at the time, but we know because we just talked about it, was that it was going to be his last supper with them. So they're all gathered. They know exactly the way it's supposed to go because they've been doing it ever since they were just little kids. And they could have led it themselves, as a matter of fact, but because Jesus was the rabbi, he leads them through it. And at one point, Jesus breaks from their tradition, breaks from what they know is supposed to happen, and he takes the bread, that is there as part of the Seder meal, right? He lifts it to God, he blesses it, or he gives thanks for it, right? And then he breaks it. And then he turns to his friends, and he said, "Now take and eat, for this is my body." He was prophesying because they didn't know, but he did, that Judas was going to betray him, right? Unbeknownst to them, the betrayal had already begun. "This is my body broken for you. Every time you eat from the bread, remember that you have been called to be the body of Christ, to be my reflection to the world, that you have been called to be united, to find unity in this perfect kind of love, unconditional love. Every time you eat from the bread, you're supposed to remember that. Not just today when I preached on it, but every time you eat from the bread, remember that. You are the body of Christ." After the meal, Jesus takes the cup. He lifts it to God. He blesses it. And he turns to his friends and he says, "Now take and drink, for this is the cup of a new covenant." And then he says it, right? "My blood shed for the forgiveness of sin." He's prophesying again. They have no idea, but he knows that they'll put a crown of thorns upon his head. He'll be whipped with a cat of nine tails until he almost bleeds out. He knows that they'll drive nails through his hands and stick a spear in his side. "This is the cup of a new covenant," he said. "My blood shed for the forgiveness of sin." Every time you drink from the cup, you're supposed to remember. The world will tell you that you are defined by your sin. Stop listening to the world. You have a choice. If you want to listen to the world, that you are defined by your own sin, you have that choice, but he is saying to you, that's what this is about. He's saying, that's not the way God's looking at you. When God looks at you because of what Jesus did on the cross, right? Because of the shed blood on the cross, when God looks at you, he says, "Man, he's handsome." Or, "I think she's the sweetest thing ever." I'm serious. That's the way he thinks when he looks at you. Because he doesn't see your sin. He sees you. This child that he created and that he was willing to give everything for in order to have as part of the family. Isn't that beautiful? I love that. Remember, that's what God thinks of you. I'm going to ask my communion stewards to come forward. And as they're doing that and preparing, as they're coming forward, I'm going to give you just a few instructions. I don't know what y'all believe. I know in the Christian church, we don't always agree on everything. There's Christians believe different things about the sacrament. It's okay. If you believe things that you think are different than what I believe, it's all right. God is inviting you to come. We are invited together, not in what we disagree about, but in this, we are united. We find unity in this perfect love that he's calling us to. You are invited. Everyone is invited. Those little kids sitting out there in the hallway are getting ready to come in here. They're invited to communion. Everyone is. Doesn't matter how old you are, how young you are, whether you're a member of this church or any church, the only thing that matters is, do you want to get to know this Jesus and to experience this unconditional love more? If you do, you should come. It's up to you, but you should come. What we'll have you do is you'll come down to the center. Nobody will dismiss you, by the way. You just, when you're ready, you come by the center aisle. There'll be two sets of communion stewards here. Someone will give you a piece of bread and say, "This is the body and the blood," or "the body of Christ given to you." Then someone else will give you a little cup with juice in it and will say, "This is the blood of Christ shed for you." And then if you'd like to spend some time up here in front praying after you've received the elements, I hope you will, And then when you're ready, you'll notice on the end of the front row here, there's little baskets for you to put your glasses in if you like. You can take them home with you if you want. It's okay. But then you can return to your seats by the side aisles. Just remember that as you come today, Jesus loves you. And he just thinks you're awesome. And we are going to have the kids come forward first. So come on up, you guys. Mark, if you want to go ahead and start the music.
Hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you, and a friend who understands everything you're going through. Keep standing at a distance in the shadow of your shame. But there's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place and bring it all. Nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. He can see the weight you carry. Fears and hopes you're. But through the cross you've been forgiven. You're accepted as you are. So bring it all to the table. It's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your trials, all your worries and your burdens, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. Nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table.
Start on the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty. nothing left to give, oh, the shape that we were in. Just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. He said, come to the table, come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come meet this motley crew of misfits, these liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. So that sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you near. Come to the table.
You, and I thank you for this beautiful new thing called love. And this call that you've laid upon us to love each other, to love the world, as you showed to us in such a beautiful and unique way. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege that we have. It says in at the very end of that prayer in John chapter 17, Jesus, you conclude your prayer to your Papa by saying, the same love that you have given to me, I have shared with them, with my people, that they might have it too. May we share it with the world. We love you, Lord, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand and join me in worship. Let's give it all up to him this afternoon.
Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Arms wide open, pouring out my life, gracefully broken. My heart stands in awe of your name, your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me. You won't win me. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life, gracefully broken.
Here I am.
Now,
let's hold nothing back.
holding nothing back, holding nothing back.
Let's give it up.
I surrender. I surrender.
Jesus, we are broken before you, Lord. We are so humbled by your mercy, Lord. We didn't deserve anything that you did. We didn't deserve for you to condescend and become a human like us and to live a life full of love, to give us an example. We certainly didn't deserve for you to die in our place, Lord. And we most certainly don't deserve to be raised to life again, to live with you forever and ever, Lord. In a perfect eternity, with no pain, with no sorrow, with no suffering. That's all because of you, Jesus. And Lord, make it our heart's desire to go and share that message, Lord. Pour us out like an offering before you, Lord, so that the fragrance can rise to you, Lord, and that you might be pleased with us, Lord, that you can say, well done, when we finally reach the end. That's our prayer today. Please send us out. In your name, Jesus. Amen.